seat. Welcome, friends and family of Brandon and Britt. I know that the couple is so thankful and happy that you all are here to celebrate this wonderful ceremony with them. I'm going to start with a word of prayer, so please bow your heads. Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for the love that Brandon and Brittany have for each other, and we thank you that we can celebrate that today. We pray a blessing over this couple, and we pray a blessing over this day. In Jesus' name. Wow, what a nice day. Oh wait, it's January in Minnesota. It's not a nice day. So which one of you two crazy people decided on January 13th for your wedding? So just so you all know out there, I overheard the couple, and they said that everybody that came out and braved the weather, that they were going to buy a ticket to go with to Mexico. Brandon, don't worry. All you have to do is get your father-in-law to pay for it all. I heard that he was some sort of a big shot. He's like a V something, whatever that is. I didn't come up here to talk to you guys about the weather, although that's kind of the Minnesota go-to, isn't it? I actually came up here to talk to you all about old-fashioned wedding vows. Brandon and Britt are about to take their wedding vows, so I thought it would be fun to talk about vows a little bit. Specifically, I wanted to talk to you about to love and cherish. It's part of many old-fashioned wedding vows. Love, obviously, still is part of all vows, but cherish, maybe not as much anymore. It's kind of an old-fashioned word, and I think a lot of people maybe would even have a hard time defining it. But first, what is a vow? Dictionary.com says a vow is a solemn promise, pledge, or personal commitment. We use these in marriage vows, which is obviously what we're talking about today. There are also vows of secrecy and even vows of silence. I don't know if this is the longest vow of silence ever recorded, but this guy named John Francis, I looked it up, and he decided to be silent for a day just to see if he could do it, and he ended up being silent for 17 years. Isn't that crazy? Back to wedding vows. Wedding vows have their origin in the Common Book of Prayer from 1549. Before that, typically a dowry was given from the father of the groom to the father of the bride. Sorry, Ryan, but you missed out on getting a dowry by about 500 years. But what does the Bible say about vows? Numbers chapter 30, verse 2 says, if a man makes a vow to the Lord or swears an oath to bind himself by some agreement, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceeds out of his mouth. And in Deuteronomy chapter 23, verses 21 to 23, it says, when you make a vow to the Lord your God, you shall not delay to pay it, for the Lord your God will surely require it of you, and it would be sin to you. But if you abstain from vowing, it shall not be sin to you. That which has gone from your lips, you shall keep and perform, for you voluntarily vow to the Lord your God what you have promised with your mouth. So taking a vow before God is a very meaningful and a very serious thing. It should not be done lightly. So what does it mean then to take a vow to love and to cherish? Well, let's look at what the Bible says about the word love. There are actually four Greek words used in the Bible that are all translated love in English. Storge, phileo, eros, and agape. Storge is familial love. This is a love between family members. In the Bible, we see this love and the concern that Jairus has for his daughter. We also see this love when Martha and Mary are concerned about their brother Lazarus. Interestingly, in both passages, they die and Jesus raises them from the dead. A second word is the word phileo. This is brotherly love. This is where the city of Philadelphia gets its name. It's the city of brotherly love. This is love between friends. In the Bible, we see this love when Lazarus dies and Jesus is weeping for his friend. The third word is eros, which is romantic love. This is the love that a man and woman share when they're married. And fourth, we have the word agape. This is God's love. It's unconditional and it's perfect. This is the love that was displayed to us on the cross when Jesus died for us. He took our punishment of his own free will because he loves us so much. This is the word used in the most famous verse in the whole Bible, John 3:16. For God so agapeo the world, or for God so loved the world that he gave his one only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. This is the love that's also described in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. This is God's love for us, and this is the kind of love that we should all be striving for in our marriages and our relationships. So then, to take a vow to love one another grand and good is to love without putting any conditions on it. To put the needs of your spouse ahead of your own, to believe in each other and in your future together, and to endure all of life's struggles together, leaning on each other when life gets difficult. Next, what does the word cherish mean? Well, Britannica says that cherish means to feel and show great love for someone. So Britannica says that love and cherish are basically the same. I don't think so. Wikipedia says to treat with affection, care, and tenderness, to nurture or protect with care. That's getting a little bit better. I actually really like what the Free Dictionary says. It says to have the highest regard for, to prize, to treasure, to recognize the worth, the quality, the importance, and the magnitude of. So what does the Bible say about cherish? Well, in the Bible, we have the chapter on love, which is the one I just read to you guys from, 1 Corinthians 13. We also have the book in the Old Testament called the Song of Solomon, or the Song of Songs. I believe that this book in the Old Testament is all about cherishing. This next piece is from a book called Cherish by Gary Thomas. So, love is about being gracious and selfless. 1 Corinthians 13:4 says, love is patient, love is kind. Cherish, on the other hand, is about being enthusiastic and enthralled. Song of Solomon 4:10 says, how much more pleasing is your love than mine, and the fragrance of your perfume more than any spice. Love is quiet and understated. 1 Corinthians 13:4 says, love does not envy, it does not boast. Cherish, on the other hand, boasts boldly and loudly. Song of Solomon 5:10 says, my beloved is radiant and ruddy, outstanding among 10,000. Love thinks about others with selflessness. 1 Corinthians 13:4 and 5, love is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking. Cherish thinks about its beloved with praise. Song of Solomon 2:14. Your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. Love doesn't want the worst for someone. 1 Corinthians 13:6 says, love does not delight in evil. Cherish celebrates the best in someone. Song of Solomon 1:15. How beautiful you are, my darling. Oh, how beautiful. Love puts up with a lot. 1 Corinthians 13:7. Love always hopes, always perseveres. Cherish enjoys a lot. Song of Solomon 5:16. His mouth is sweetness itself. He is altogether lovely. Love is about commitment. 1 Corinthians 13:7 and 8. Love endures all things. Love never ends. Cherish is about delight and passion. Song of Solomon 1:3. Your name is like perfume and pourful. Love and cherish never compete with each other. They complement each other, and they even complete each other. So to take a vow to cherish one another, Brandon and Britt, is to hold your spouse in the highest regard, to prize them, to treasure them above all others, to recognize their worth, their quality, and their importance, building one another up by declaring these things to each other. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, it says, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is fair, whatever is pure, whatever is acceptable, whatever is commendable, if there is anything of excellence, and if there is anything praiseworthy, keep thinking about these things. Take this verse and apply it to your spouse. Think about the good things, then tell your spouse what they are. Treasure the great things about your spouse and highlight them every day, continually building each other up. This world is so good at tearing us down. A married couple should always be looking for ways to build each other up. That's what's so great about finding that special someone to spend your life with. You have a partner and a friend to help when life gets difficult. You can face this world together, locking arms and strengthening each other against life's battles. That's what it means to cherish. Both to love and to cherish are choices that we have to make on a daily basis. In fact, it's not a choice. It's 100 choices, 1,000 choices, and then 100,000 choices. Start each day, Brandon and Britt, with the thoughts, how can I bless my wife today? How can I encourage my husband today? How can I lift her up? How can I make him feel loved? Make it a competition. Who can bless the other more each day? Can you imagine how many more successful marriages we would have if every husband and wife cherished their spouses like this? So with the vows you are about to take, Brandon and Rick, this is what you are vowing to do. You are vowing to selflessly put the other ahead of yourself. You are vowing to passionately treasure each other above all others. You are vowing to endure life's struggles together, leaning on each other when life gets difficult. You are vowing to hold the one you're with in the highest regard. You are vowing to fight for your marriage, believing in each other and in your future together. You are vowing to shout from the rooftops how great and wonderful your spouse is. That's what it means to take a vow to love and cherish one another, and that's what you two are here today to commit to. It's a beautiful thing. Love and cherish, they are such beautiful words. They've lost a lot of meaning over the years, but I think if we can get back to their true meanings, a marriage that's built on these will be incredibly strong. It will take a lot of work and dedication, but it will be so worth it. Brandon and Britt, the decision that you are making today to build your life on loving and cherishing each other is the foundation of a marriage that will last forever. Okay, can I have a couple please hold hands? Brandon, do you intend to take this woman whose hand you hold to be your lawful wedded wife? And do you pledge before God and man to love, honor, and protect her through sunshine and shadow alike, keeping yourself unto her alone, loving and cherishing her until death shall separate you? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Britt, do you intend to take this man whose hand you hold to be your lawful wedded husband? And do you pledge before God and man to be to him a loving and true wife through sunshine and shadow alike, keeping yourself unto him alone, loving and cherishing him until death shall separate you? And so answer, I do. Brandon, please repeat after me. I, Brandon, take you, Britt.
I, Brandon,
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Excluding all others.
Excluding all others.
As long as we both shall live. With God as my witness.
With God as my witness.
I give you my pledge.
I give you my pledge.
Britt, please repeat after me. I, Britt, take you, Brandon.
I, Britt, take you, Brandon.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
And
to love and to cherish.
Love and cherish.
Excluding all others.
Excluding all others.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
With God as my witness.
With God as my witness.
I give you my pledge.
Give you my pledge.
You have chosen to seal your vows by giving and receiving of rings. The ring forms a perfect circle, without a beginning or an end, and is thereby a symbol of eternity, and signifies the duration of the commitment you are making. The gold of which the rings are made signifies the purity and value of the relationship of what you enter. Let us now exchange these rings. Brandon, you have the privilege of placing this ring on Britt's finger in virtue of the exclusive covenant relationship into which you now enter. Repeat after me. I give you this ring, as a symbol of my vow, and with all that I am, and with all that I have, I will honor you. As a symbol of my vow, and with all that I am,
and with all that I have,
I will honor you. And now, with the authority invested in me as a minister of the gospel, and in accordance with the laws of the state of Minnesota, I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss the bride. And Mrs. Wayne.